Okay, let's hope those who are still here are interested to hear what kind of declaration is in among the papers that were given. Michael, thank you. Now I know that somebody reads the handouts. It's nice to know. And if you look among your papers, you should find a very, well, modestly looking white paper with black letters. But I believe that inside, on that paper, there are some important things written. And I will start from introducing my fellow panelists, distinguished gentlemen. Yes, we still have to work on gender balance, but all those men who are here represent civil society platforms, which there are six of them in three countries, which we discussed today. So each country has two platforms, one belonging to the Eastern Partnership Framework, the Eastern Partnership Civil Society Forum, and those platforms exist for some 7-8 years. And then we have a new breed of civil society platforms, those that were introduced by the association agreements. And those platforms are here represented, except for one Moldovan bilateral platform, thanks, well, it's not polite to say thanks to the leader of that platform, but he did not manage to come, and now I have where to sit, so that's also good. But let's go back to the declaration, why we all are here. On the eve of the forum, we had an idea that there is this idea of three countries that need to cooperate much more, that need to align their positions, that need to have a joint advocacy strategy towards Brussels, and then request Brussels to have some kind of coordinated policy towards them. And the idea was that who, if not civil society, comes with clear statements, what should be done, when should be done, and who should be engaged in this process. And, well, you know that somebody mentioned, I guess, the ambassador, that sometimes declarations require long negotiations and battles to agree every letter, but not in this case. So indeed, in a very short period, the platforms came up with a quite short, but in essence, containing all the provisions that civil society believes are important. And you can, I don't want to read it out because it would be boring and you will all sleep. But you should have a look at that document, and I would underline just some phrases or some provisions that sound important to civil society. So it's basically the message is that the region has evolved, the situation has changed, and now the six countries of the Eastern Partnership chosen a different path. And the three of them, those who took commitments under association agreements, really have moved much more forward and require a different format of relationship also between themselves and with the European Union to be able to promote and share the experience, to coordinate policy, and to ensure mutual support in on their path to the European Union. And the platforms believed that the trilateral format requires some sort of institutionalization to be effective and to be real, to be material. Also, they call for support, mutual support of the countries in reaching, ensuring the political criteria of EU membership. Also, focus should be given to facilitating trade and build a common market with a free movement of goods, services, capital, and persons. So integrating also between themselves would be a step forward and a step towards integration into the EU single market. And also definitely the security issues and counteracting hybrid threats and other security challenges should be a focus of cooperation of the three countries. And next, well, just as a conclusion, the policy, the EU integration policy should be upgraded. And to ensure that the countries which did not get the EU membership promise as they want, but still continue to be interested in deeper integration into the EU, they need to have a de facto integration when without the formal status of a member or candidate members, the countries could get closer and integrate into the EU markets. And to ensure all that, the platforms propose to act on all levels, starting from the government to the parliament and to civil society, but also are calling the EU to support this cooperation. So it is believed that the dialogue should take place, effective dialogue. This is also kind of dialogue, but we want a sustained dialogue of all actors. And the civil society platforms who took lead in this initiative, they want to show by their example that a cooperation is possible and that it's possible to agree positions of different countries of we didn't count how many members together we have, how many civil society organizations are in those platforms, but I believe many of them, and those are the most active, the most knowledgeable organizations in the region, and they do call other actors, the government, the parliaments, to join this initiative, and not only to deliver nice speeches at the conferences, but also to do what they say. So, and I'm stopping here because we really have experts from the three countries and they have much more to say about their vision, how the three countries can really cooperate with each other, provide mutual support on their path towards the European Union, towards deeper integration. And here we can take some examples of those regional alliances on the way to the European Union, like Visegrad countries, also the Baltic states, and also try to be, as our panel says, allies in integration, partners in integration. So please, we will go in the alphabetical order of the country of origin. So I would first invite to speak, no, not Ukraine, not this time. Let's be hospitable. We will invite to speak Kaha Gogolashvili, who has many titles, but I will introduce him as co-chair of the Georgian EU Civil Society Platform.
Yeah, thank you very much, Zoriana. First of all, I would like to thank very much the Renaissance Foundation because it's a third association exchange forum that they already organize and each year. So 3 years ago, they already were started to be dedicated to the idea of three associated states to work together. This is very strong idea. Maybe it's not very well understood everywhere, and unfortunately even not in the governments, but they have all of our governments, they have all some important and serious problems. So I can see that it's not as easy to try to create something new, especially on international level. And especially when all three countries have problems. So we should admit that nor Georgia, nor Ukraine, nor Moldova, we are perfect countries. We have so many problems that some of our maybe officials or politicians, they think that if we join efforts, it means that we join also problems. We need to deal with each other's problems, and so everything could be spoiled. But I think that this is not a correct vision. I think that despite of the problems, yesterday in Moldova, it was shocking for me, that not shocking, I was expecting, but still, it's not very unpleasant news, that the pro-European government was impeached, practically. This is, I imagine that now the future of trilateral cooperation and with a strong dedication to European integration and all these plans, they are not just like something well clear. This is unclear, but I think that real politician and real courageous people, they look over the difficulties towards the future. And what is the future? Future of these three countries is integration to the European Union. Would it be functional integration for the foreseeable future or full-fledged integration, institutional integration to the European Union? It matters, but it doesn't matter for the process. The process is for us to integrate functionally at this stage and to work together on that. Why to work together? Because it's a simple international experience that practically we see that practically all enlargements, EU enlargements, they matter on the regional basis. So they take some region, they look to this region and say, well, there are some countries which can cooperate among themselves, and also we can look as an area of enlargement, of our enlargement. Would it be a southern enlargement, so-called, or enlargement towards this the Scandinavian space, or would it be enlargement to Central and Eastern Europe, and now Western Balkans at stake? And what is the next? Why Georgia should expect that Georgia will be taken alone and saying, oh, Georgia is a wonderful country, let's work on integration of Georgia into Europe. This is very unlikely. What is likely? Likely is that three countries, they create a kind of area aspiring to become EU, becoming compatible with EU economically, legally, different other, all kind of, in all kind of directions, they are becoming similar to EU, more or less. And in the same time, the convergence between these countries and cooperation and integration of these countries grow. Then we create some kind of space for future EU enlargement. This is real, to my view. Otherwise, it would be difficult to do alone something. And this is one thing. Second, that we see that this partnership has become a little bit fraying some of the countries. Like on multilateral track, we have six countries, but three of them as part. As Vice, I agree totally with Vice Prime Minister Kuleba, that saying that there is real differentiation in visions, in aspirations of this country, but there is no differentiation inside of Eastern Partnership. Why should we expect differentiation inside of Eastern Partnership? Nobody wants to destroy this very nice and very useful format of six countries working together in order to implement somehow European rules and to Europeanize this full post-Soviet space, European part of the post-Soviet space, at least. This is very important for all of us to work together. But why, if we want to differentiate and to take another speed, and the people also speak about multiple integrational speeds, right? We can take other speed, but how? Then we need to create ourselves. If there is no intention from European Union to create something new for these three countries or to distinguish them inside of Eastern Partnership, we can go outside of Eastern Partnership to create something among ourselves and to reinforce our efforts to do something together. So to show, to make more more communication and more advertising of us as some countries aspiring not just EU membership, but functional integration with the EU. And what we should do then, and how we reinforce each other's efforts, I think that very good and very well-known example of this Visegrad, cooperation of Visegrad 4 format, which was encouraged by EU in the beginning of 1990s, 1994, I think it was, the countries which became practically, for that time, just potential candidates, not officially potential candidates, but they were seen as a future candidates of European Union, not yet accession countries. They've been advised to create a kind of cooperation of format between themselves and to encourage each other on the path of European integration, also to liberalize everything between them, so to create a free space for movement, for European freedoms, as we call them usually, and to join efforts in different directions, which is important for complying Copenhagen criteria, for example. In our case, we should do the same. We need to cooperate with each other, not just with Europe looking to European Union, but also we can cooperate with each other. We can monitor each other. We can take obligations and we can commit to each other to do something. For example, reform of judiciary, would it be reform, any kind of political reform, or create economic space which is more transparent, which is facilitating joint ventures, increase in business, which increase in trade with each other, in order to make this space closer, also economically, and more interested in each other. Also, the development of the infrastructure, infrastructural links, connectivity, etc., which is mentioned in this declaration, of course, and should be fully supportive. I think all this is very important. It could be reached by creating first this the same kind of format like it is Visegrad Group. There is one word saying that which is not absolutely must, I think, this is to create secretariat. Visegrad 4 doesn't have secretariat, but there is commitment that every year each country provides service to this, so takes presidency and provides the technical support, administrative support, developing agenda, facilitating discussions, etc. One country can do it. We can do the same. One year Ukraine can become presidency of this kind of format that we will create, and Ukraine will deal with agendas and with development. So next year it will be Georgia, next year it will be Moldova, etc. So I think taking this path, we can ask European Union to look at us, to focus, to concentrate on three of us, and to start to enter the dialogue with us, with all three of us. Why it is important? Because three of us will be stronger to dealing and talking to European Union. We know our problems, yes, thank you. European Union will always say us, you have such as problems, we know our problems. But we also can, three of us, know very well our aspirations and we know what we want from European Union. So demanding, working all three, lobbying our interests with the European Union, which is 28 or 27, I can't fully understand at this moment, it's 28 or 27, but doesn't matter, it's too much, it's difficult. So I think that I will finalize here. So it's again, thank you, Zoriana, and all your foundation for this initiative, for your dedication, for your work, and I hope very much that our officials and not just ministries of foreign affairs, but on the highest level, will share and meet soon and start meeting regularly on the highest level, on the experts level, on others level. And the last word is about civil society. Of course, the I support also very much the declaration says that civil society is also should create. I think we should not wait civil society. Now in this here, I see that mainly we are civil society. I see some officials, then thank you very much to them. But still, we are here civil society. And I think we should not wait when the governments will be ready to talk to each other. leads us to show, first of all, to our governments that we are force, that we are strong, that we are strongly dedicated and understanding the issue. We are serious about it. And then when the government sees, maybe they will start gathering and they will do these things. And then government will show to European Union that we are very serious. Thank you very
much. Thank you, Vasha. Thank you, Kaha, for being so such a good friend of Ukraine. I'm already thinking of the next speaker. So Lasha Tagushi, who chairs the other civil society platform in Georgia. And please, could you share some brief remarks? What, in your view, could be done to mutually enhance each other for the three countries on their way to the European Union? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Georgians. And, first of all, thank you, Zoriana, and your foundation, Renaissance Foundation, for this opportunity to offer signing of the memorandum between our platforms. We convened a steering committee of the Georgian National Platform and discussed the declaration after when Kaha sent us the draft of declaration. And ultimately, the steering committee supported the declaration and decided to make a proposal with regard to signing of the memorandum between representatives of three countries, and I mean civil societies, especially our platforms. This could also lead to the creation of common platform that would focus on different issues, including initiation of new collaborative ideas. We definitely need to go further. It's no doubt. What do we observe around us? Profound changes taking place both in Europe and in our countries. We witness fundamental challenges which have arisen recently. It's a lot of bad things happened in our countries. For instance, the far right, very active and very aggressive, very dangerous groups mushrooming almost every day in Georgia. I know that the same thing happened in other countries also. It's quite dangerous, I think. I think, again, we are losing position, and given that we must not wait but act, we can structurize a three-party dialogue, and it is us who should lead this initiative. There is no doubt that these three associated countries have a common political vector and common interests, which are also common to our civil societies and platforms. At the same time, I'm convinced that our initiative will give a positive impetus to other members of the Eastern Partnership countries. And, you know, there are so much speculations if we three countries go further, what others should do, and maybe it's a bad for them. I think if we go further, it's a best way for others also. And finally, I think probably it's reasonable to create, maybe today, maybe tomorrow, some working group which will be in charge of elaborate kind of memorandum and define timing, day, and we will go further as soon as possible to sign this memorandum. On behalf of Georgian side, I can say we are ready. We are very supportive, and we were thinking it's very important to do it. Thank you, Dorian.
Thank you very much. And now I encourage to speak the only representative of Moldova here. Both platforms have supported the declaration, but only Ion Manole from the Eastern Partnership Platform is able to be here. And I encourage you to say a few words. How do you see from Chisinau, especially in your current challenging position, the prospects for the three countries going together? And why do you believe it's important for you?
Thank you, Zoriana. It's a pleasure for me to be here today and speak in front of you. Of course, the situation in Moldova is not very positive at the moment, but we continue to keep our hope for positive evolution in our country, of course. You know, when I received the invitation and I saw the topic of our discussions regarding the new format or another format of Visegrad for our countries, for our three countries, I decided that this is a very good idea, and this idea is also is supported by my colleagues from National Platform and another platform with whom I spoke yesterday and today. First of all, we agree, we will support this. We think that we are condemned to be together and to collaborate together. And I would like to emphasize few aspects and which, in my opinion, are very important to be taken in account when we discuss about this new format or another format of V4 countries. So, first of all, Georgia, Moldova, and Ukraine have the same past, so we have the same history, at least last 50, 100 years. Also, we have common aspirations and similar hopes for future, but also we face with the same challenges. From this point of view, the idea is very good, in my opinion. I like very much, and we will support this. And as I mentioned, we are condemned to collaborate and to work together. From my point of view, the main obstacle to copy exactly the Visegrad format is security issue. The presence of the Russian troops in our countries and the occupation and control of the part from our territories is a serious problem for our political, economical, but also military stability, but also independence. And I mean here real independence. And my country probably is the most relevant example in this context. So these aspects can be an obstacle, but probably we, civil society, should transform them in the argument for our development, for development of our countries. And I fully agree that together we can achieve better and faster results. Yes, I will emphasize the word faster. We lost 30 years. 30 years of very important opportunities. And now we are the most poorest region in Europe without active and active part of population. At least this is the case of my country. So I think that we need another V4 group format, but probably we with some elements from Marshall Plan and Truman Doctrine. I started to think about these elements at least because the West faced 70 years ago with the same challenges after the Second World War. In this context, the role of civil society organizations is very important, and we will continue to play active and positive role despite all political turmoils. But here I would like to emphasize that civil society need not only financial support, but also political support. I represent here National Platform, but I come from human rights organization. We are human rights defenders, organization which work in Transnistria region for the last 15 years. And we work a lot in the legal field. And we think that it is time to work and to speak more about reforms in international organizations. And here, probably, the last events and last decision regarding United Nations, I mean, Ukraine, positive result in this area, we should congratulate Ukraine and work together in this direction. So in this context, I would like to congratulate Ukrainians with the latest success. And to continue to speak about our case, when we have dozens of decisions on international of European Court, international court, which are ignored by Russian government, we face with a very serious challenges. The role of Western community is to keep trust in international law and international rules. If in Russian government in this case ignored to execute European Court decision, international decisions. This is a signal that Russia would like to compromise the credibility of international rules and international norms. This is why these aspects are very important. Only my organization have at the moment more than 50 cases and decisions from European Court which are ignored by Russian government. And this is a problem for people, because now at the moment people don't trust in international court and international rules and norms, and this is a very positive aspect for Russian Federation. So I would like
probably
to stop
here. I would also like you to stop. Thank you. And I would ask Ivan Korchitsky from the bilateral EU-Ukraine platform to say a couple of words. Where does he see the potential of trilateral advance, so to say?
Okay, thanks, Zaryana. I try to repeat some key words from previous session. You remember about wider society. And if you, in our platform, in the bilateral platform, our main focus is economical reform. People understand EU integration as a result of the reform with different sectors. As not at the same time understand the political level or international level. There is more easy to understand in the Eastern Partnership platform. As a partner, a member of this platform, have more experience to participate in international events and in other kind of dialogue. And now, if we, I have some concrete case. For example, you hear today about Horizon 2020 on digital version. There is a relation from human capital. Our development is a relation from human capital is young people. And human capital is a relation from innovation. And innovation is a close relation from economical development, from concurrency position, our economy in the global world. What we can do in this sector? And if there I have a concrete example. Our four countries, not only Moldova, Ukraine, and Belarus, also Armenia, have agreement of association Horizon 2020. We have a big difference, result of Ukraine, for example, and the result of the Belarus. We have association Horizon 2020, and we use additional possibility, and we can be the coordinator. For example, I not only play role of the member of two platform, I also was national contact point ICT in Horizon 20. I also represent Ukraine in ICT committee of Horizon 2020. I can possibly to influence the program of the research in this area. Now we work on the digital agenda. We have contact with our government in this area. I mean, also contact in the international level. And now I have a question. Is this, we have relation from instant partnership or no? Of course. I have given another example about cyber society, cyber security. There is problem for all country, and there need to close cooperation in the international level. As we don't have a big difference between local reform and international level. But we have some strong problem in some sector where we can have more deeper reform in the our sector, in the bilateral cooperation. And then we have some problem that we can discuss in the international level on the trilateral or more extend cooperation from other countries of all partnership countries. Thanks.
Thank you very much. And the last but not least would be Yuri Vdovenko. Actually, the first signatory to the declaration was the Ukrainian National Platform, was the steering committee of the Ukrainian National Platform of the Eastern Partnership Forum. So I would like you to conclude or maybe say a few words. Why do you think it's important? Why do you inspire this declaration?
First of all, I really glad to see friends from Georgia, from Moldova, from European Union, but I should say that I'd prefer to see here partners from all AP countries. Unfortunately, after 10 years of this initiative, we see that we're really on different tracks, and three associated countries move faster to European Union, and today civil society platforms show the example how we can bring together our efforts. We hope that our governments and other officials will follow this way. You mentioned about Baltic states, about Visegrad Group, about Western Balkans. It seems for us that now good time. It is good time and good opportunity to add to this list associated agreement countries as a new bloc, which countries which have aims to become members of European Union family. Of course, we should say not about policy, but also about concrete steps. And there are no Ukrainian officials right now here, but I should say that in our case, we are on the same page, and we even started such discussions. We have some preliminary list of ideas, of initiatives which we can realize together for our three countries. Of course, we have a broader agenda for EAP6. Of course, we have a very crucial factor which unites us, it's Russia Federation and the influence of it. But at the same time, we have even broader agenda for our three countries, and it's not about common initiatives, not only about common projects, coordination, but it's about the final goal of our struggling on the way to European integration. You saw this declaration. Feel free to add any ideas, because I suppose that we're really in the beginning of this way, and this way will be successful.
Thank you very much. Want to thank all the contributors to this discussion, but also give a chance of to the audience to raise a few questions. Yes, I already see Mr. Pataka Prindashvili, who can give a microphone? It's better that you take one.
Thank you. I admire this memorandum or declaration or whatever it's called, joint declaration. And I applaud really to the authors for this piece of paper, which is important if it is taken in the context of deepening relations of Ukraine, Moldova, and Georgia with the European Union. Now, I'm gonna have a question, kind of a comment and question to Yuri and to all of you, whoever wants to respond. Well, Yuri, you said that the government in Ukraine is on board. And in fact, you've started already addressing this issue, which means that Ukrainian government has been supportive to institutionalize the cooperation among three, to create a specific format with a secretariat, etc. Did you talk on the resources? Are you aware if they are going to spare some resources, both human and financial? That's my first question. And second question is about the European Union. Now, the last sentence says that, and there is a call on the EU to support the trilateral cooperation, etc. But I think it's rather my comment. I've been a great enthusiast. I've been in my organization, together with my colleagues in Georgia, quite a staunch advocate for the trio format for some time now. However, we should not have this illusion that the European Union would be very forthcoming from the very beginning and would support, you know, this kind of offer from us. Would you like to comment on that? That if the European Union would not be supported from the very beginning, that still this endeavor should be taking place. I mean, even without the EU's support from the beginning. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else? There is one more hand. Please, could we take that question too, and then we will have answers and conclude this day on this positive note.
Yes, my name is Matthias Nellis. I'm with the Center for Liberal Modernity, a Berlin-based think tank, and my question is pretty much similar, but if you walk through the Maidan here, you will see an organization which is called GUAM, which was founded in the 90s, and I wanted to follow up and ask, what is the difference of an institutionalization of the kind that you're recommending and what has been attempted? So maybe you can share your thoughts on why GUAM has failed and should be replaced by what you're suggesting, or how should and fits GUAM in your picture. That would be interesting to me. Thank you.
Thank you. Very interesting question. Okay, so who wants to answer? Yuri? Maybe somebody on GUAM?
Maybe I will start with the first questions. First of all, of course, East-Europe partnership brought a lot of positive cases to our countries with a lot of resources. Mainly, of course, it was technical assistance, and now we can see that only with technical assistance we can't move forward with faster without infrastructure support. So, of course, the resources inside the Eastern Partnership programs are huge at this moment, and when we talk about dividing policy, it means also dividing these resources. At the same time, we should invest from our side to this approach. I'm afraid that with 20 key deliverables, which we have now till 2020, and with possibility to continue maybe with 30 deliverables till 2030, we only can slow down our progress in cooperation. First of all, it's another dividing resources inside the Eastern Partnership, and of course investing from side of our countries. Even when you realize European projects, you should co-finance them.
Okay. Are you going to take the question on GUAM, right?
Yes. Just thank you. Little bit to add to this, okay, question also, that of course EU cannot, EU has many other problems, and the Eastern Partnership is quite enough to think about, so EU doesn't think about creating itself some other formats. After all, EU is not absolutely enthusiastic, and there are many countries in EU are not enthusiastic to create some other integrational process. So we shouldn't expect that you will be very happy that Ukraine, Georgia, and Moldova together will start knocking to the. But it's our business. I'm saying we should become serious. So it's our business. We need to do it for ourselves. And of course, then when they see that we are serious, they will start consulting and talking to us, of course. And this is the plan that should be realized. If we want to take it, we have some sense of responsibilities and courage, etc. And we trust each other. We really we really are similar or not in many things. If we are similar and have similar, why don't joint efforts? This is just very simple thing. This is one thing. Second, Guam. Of course, it's absolutely different story. That somebody can say that it's a G-U-M, it's a G-U-M, Georgia, Ukraine, Moldova, and just also. It's Azerbaijan. But it's very different. It's very different. If you put, for example, a little bit red ink or any kind of ink into the water, then water becomes the same color what the ink is, right? So this is Azerbaijan, which is a neighbor of Georgia, and we have very big friendship with Azerbaijan. But unfortunately, we have no the same foreign policy priorities. And creating Ukraine, Moldova, and Georgia triangle or trio, it's about foreign policy priorities, first of all, and about internal transformation. Azerbaijan, in both things, it's not ready to join WTO. It's not ready to make transparent its borders, customs, fiscal policy, etc. So it's different type of country in this regards, with different aims. So you cannot create with Azerbaijan nor 3 nor 20 EU aspirant countries can create with Azerbaijan something which will work on European integration of this region. No, there will be other. Guam is very good politically, very important organization, I think, even if didn't succeed very much. It succeeded at least on developing projects of common projects on Europe-Asia corridor, transportation, also energy projects. Guam is helping in keeping very good political relations between all these countries and somehow resisting also Russia's political pressure and divisionary intentions to divide the region and to rule. This is very important, but it has other objectives. Then what we want to create, what the organizers of this meeting are want to create between Ukraine, Georgia, and Moldova. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I saw two hands, and that is it, because we are really abusing the patience of the audience. So first, Michael, could you please raise your hand so that the girl with the microphone finds you? And then we draw it.
Thank you very much. The issue was raised by one of the speakers as to how the EU is likely to respond to a proposal from the three if they followed what you have proposed here. I don't think there are any authorized speakers for the European institutions here present at the moment. I may be wrong. So I think I'm the nearest you can get to it. I'm an ex-EU official, but I'm now an independent. To my view, the situation is rather clear. The EU institutions are heavily invested doctrinally in the Eastern Partnership for the Six. They will not take any initiative to reinforce the Three. However, if the Three do it, say if the Three governments basically follow more or less what you are proposing, then they will be obliged to deal with it. And if that is followed through with the development of professionally serious propositions or questions or requests, they will respond probably in a relatively reasonable manner. So I think that should be the guideline. Just do it. Don't ask any silly questions. Do it and be present. The Guam question provokes has already provoked an answer. The A in the Guam, or how many A's in the Guam? I think it's Azerbaijan. It could be Armenia. Of course, the fact that Armenia is half in DCFTA land now raises the question of how the three may relate or interact with this new Armenia. We, for our part, as a think tank in Brussels, we are inclined to regard Armenia as the 3.5, you know, half in. And so there's a lot of sympathy towards trying to help Armenia make the best of this very delicate hybrid system they have. However, even so, I wouldn't recommend to the three that they add the Armenia A to the process, because that gets you into this hornet's nest of the Azeri-Armenian relationship over Nagorno-Karabakh. That's a problem that you don't have on your plate at the moment, and I guess you don't really need. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. That was not a question. Thank you for that as well. So now, Dmytro, and you are the last.
Thank you. Actually, I also don't want to put some additional questions, but rather provide additional answers to the questions which were raised, because I understand that there are some already kind of questions to the declaration to which I also to establishment of which I also have some relations. So first of all, just to clearly to underline on record that Ukrainian government was not consulted whatsoever with the essence of this declaration. This is a purely civil society initiative, which was supported by Georgians and Moldovan civil society. So far, it is only civil society initiative, but we really hope that governments, all the three governments, will listen and will hear this initiative. We shared it just before the forum with the Ukrainian government. We have yet to receive the answer, comprehensive answer to this initiative. We hope it will be positive. On Guam, just again, don't misunderstand. This is the content of this proposal, the content of this general declaration is not about creating new organization. It's about basically to accept that this is the fact on the ground. There's a group of countries already existing, associated countries, three associated countries. So it's about, really, Kacha mentioned, inspiration is rather Visegrad. This is not a formal organization. It's rather a group of countries which have some practice which is institutionalized to cooperate. And so this is kind of our model of inspiration rather than creating another international organization. Again, it's not about abolishing the format of the six. I think we all underline it, but maybe we need again and again underline it. It's not about destroying Eastern Partnership. It's about creating additional layer of Eastern Partnership, if you want, additional, more advanced track of it. And totally agree with Michael Emerson. Actually, this is what we have seen so far. When we discussed with the Ukrainian government, what I also absolutely share a perception of Yura and other colleagues, we really see that we basically share the same perception with the Ukrainian government, that we talk about this necessity for you to come up with a vision for the three countries already for more than 1 year, I think for several years already. Now what we try to push for a little bit with this joint movement from the civil societies is that don't expect you to come first with such a proposal. We need to come first with such a proposal. So this is the push for our official representatives of the three countries to come forward with such a proposal proactively, rather than to expect that Brussels will suddenly think of creating such a proposal from them. So that's just to underline some important things here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dmytro. Actually, we during the next a day and a half, we will continue those discussions, exploring this idea in many aspects. And I hope we will have more to contribute to further follow-up actions to this declaration. And I should refer to the words of the previous moderator, who said that sometimes it's difficult to convince civil society that it should be on board of European integration reforms. So I hope we would convince the governments that they should be on board, and also other actors as well. Thank you all for this beginning of the conference. I hope and I wish you all a pleasant evening tonight and more interesting and challenging discussions next days. Thank you all.